I got you a little gift.
Oh, it's so cute.
It's a tiger's eye.
Oh, I love it.
Especially with the full moon that was yesterday as well. So I thought it was appropriate.
Did you put out your moon water?
I did.
I did too.
Did you do any little rituals last night?
I did. I lit 2 candles. I have a blue one. This is cute. Can I wear it right now?
Yeah, go ahead. Who is Bree?
Bree is me. Bree is a production babe. Bree is a audio engineer, production manager, event coordinator, artist, all the things, all of the above.
How'd you get into that?
Well, my first passion and my first career was audio engineering. So when I was like really, really young, I started doing it like when I was 12, mm-hmm. but like then I was doing it professionally when I was like 15. Oh, wow. And then, yeah, so then I did that. And then, I went to college for it. So I have a BBA in business management, but also audio. So that's cool.
Fancy.
And then, yeah, I don't know. It just came from somebody, like literally somebody had told me what the definition of what an audio engineer is. And their dear friend, Joe Conserva, he's great, great engineer. He had told me what the word audio engineer was because that's what his job was at the time. And I had heard it and I was like, oh, damn. Like, I never knew what I wanted to do with my life, but that's what I want to do. I immediately was started to do it like every weekend and just consistently. And then eventually I worked at a theater and I had seen this guy walking around who was all dressed in black, but I never saw him do anything. So I walked up to him and maybe this is bold of me, but I was like, hey, what do you do here? I never like see you do anything. Like, what's your job? And he was like, I'm an audio engineer. And I was like, oh, me too. But I was just for like, you know, these small little bands. And then he was like, yo, if you want to work here, bada bing, bada boom. I ended up doing theater sound, and then the rest is kind of really history. I just tried to do everything and anything I could that was involving that. And then eventually, because I'm at events, I started to want to do more events. And then that went from like small shows to like the festival, Mayday, which is a festival thrown by Suffolk AME. They're the largest labor union in Suffolk County. They're really great. They basically throw this festival every year in May. So it was really great. We had the Spin Doctors, Smithereens, Deer Tick, Crash Test Dummies, a whole bunch of like throwbacks. And then we also had a whole bunch of local people too. We had Sahara Moon, sorry, also on the main stage. And then a whole bunch of local bands on our local stage.
That's awesome.
And there was just a whole bunch of vendors and really cool stuff. And I don't know, I really enjoyed it. It was really interesting to work with those high profile clients and talking to their tour managers and like,
you feel fancy.
Conveying emotion. It was so weird. The first time I got a phone call from the Spin Doctors tour manager, I was like, what? Okay, sure, cool. That's the biggest. And I guess my favorite really would have to be my festival, which is Pine Barrens Jam, because that is truly mine. And like, I've been here since year one. And I mean, yeah, granted, this is our second year.
I've been seeing it here and there, like on social media, and I'm still trying to figure out exactly what it is.
So Pine Barrens Jam is a festival by Long Island for Long Island, basically. Love is our that. Thing. You can find us at pinebarrensjam.com. But basically, we started this initiative, which originally, you know, with the name, we wanted to be in the Pine Barrens. But our first year, we changed venues 3 times before we ended up at our home right now, which is Bluepoint Brewery. And basically, our origin story is just that there was a whole bunch of locals who really wanted to support the local art and music community and the poetry community. And we were kind of all about those 3 different art forms, poetry, art, and music.
I love that.
So we have a main stage, acoustic stage, and those, you know, are lend way to the local artists. And then we have a poetry stage where we have the poets. And mm-hmm. then we also have live artists who are painting. And then we have vendors. So we really just try to like kind of bring together almost as many people as we can in the community to showcase what we really got here on Long Island and, you know, make it accessible.
I love that. I love it even more that it's at Bluepoint too.
Yeah, it's really nice. Honestly, like, we're so thankful that they got us the first year. You know, our venue, we lost our venue 11 days before the festival, and then we confirmed Bluepoint 8 days before. Where was it, 3? Maybe 8. I feel like it was 8.
I feel like over the years, a lot of them have been closing down too.
With the breweries?
Not the breweries, like
festivals
or like vending areas.
Not I mean, it's areas, really hard to upkeep.
Yeah.
And keep it consistent and have people continue to show up. And then it's like the audience. And then you bring in the factor of COVID where people weren't like going out. So it's really disrupted the production and entertainment industry. But there is a really big like pushback right now. Like there's stuff happening like every day. You know, once we kind of were able to go out, like I got a phone call all the time for like gigs and the doing events and stuff, because everyone just kind of was like, we want to go out, we want to be out.
Yeah.
So I think right now we are actually in like a little bit of a revival of the arts.
I completely agree.
But yeah.
How did you feel about Toasted Tuesdays?
Sorry, I'm parched. Toasted Tuesdays are really cool. Honestly, Pine Barrens, how I first started doing it, and we were vending as Pine Barrens Jam. And basically, at first, I didn't even really know fully who was running it or like what it was or what the facts were. But like the first time I was there, it was just like this all-encompassing, I don't know, energy.
Yeah.
It's like really, I know you vend it all the time, so like you know what I'm talking about. It's like, it's just a vibe.
Yeah, no, it is. Brian was saying that too when I was recording with him. It's a totally different vibe. And like, this is what I tell people, like to get people to come. Cops have never come there. There's never been any of the Toasted Tuesdays, any fights breaking out, nothing like that, because everyone's chilling. People are still drinking, but they're also smoking there too.
It's a really weird dynamic for people to be smoking outside at the brewery. Like the first time that I went there and it like was a thing, I was like, what?
Especially the dab bar.
Yeah.
I love seeing people.
It feels
like,
illegal.
I love seeing people for the first time see the dab bar and they're like, they're just doing that in the open. I'm like, yeah, it's legal now. Yeah.
It's so interesting to me too. Cause like, you know, there's smoking areas that are enforced and then like now there's like places that are changing their rules or adapting. And it's very interesting. I don't know what's going to happen with it, but I think it's really cool that we're allowed to do it. And now that the recreational use is, you know, allowed, it's kind of like you bring all these different walks of life together. And I don't know, there's something about stoners that they're just really nice and really happy. So, like, that's almost like a bonding point. And then it really doesn't matter who you are, what you look like, what you dress like. People are like, all right, cool, you're cool.
And now, a word from our sponsors. Maxwell Snacks, for all your THC-infused needs. From delicious fruity gummies and teas, vegan options are coming soon, to their newest hash hole products as well. For more information about how to place an order or when they'll be vending next, make sure to check out their Instagram, which is linked right in the description. Maxwell Snacks, maximum wellness snacks.
Speaking about smoking, so when was the first time you smoked?
My sister. I asked her, I was like, yo, I want to know what this is like. Because I had a girlfriend at the time who did, and I was like, she doesn't, she's cool, so.
But that's the best way to do it. That my, when my brother asked me, I was just like, I'd rather you come to me. I know where it's coming from. I am with you when you're, you know, smoking for the first
time. I think it's so funny that it happened that way. But it was genuinely, I was always told, like, I grew up in a household where it was like, don't do drugs. Drugs are bad for you, and, like, you're going to end up, you know, like a deadbeat.
Weed's a gateway drug.
Exactly. So I was like, I was always like scared of it. And then when I had my girlfriend, she did it. I was like, well, she's a really good person and she makes really good decisions. And like, huh, interesting. And then I asked my sister, I was like, hey, I have literally no clue how to do this or like what to do. And I want your guidance and your help. So she was like my shaman of sorts, or guide, or whatever you want to call her. And she took me to a baseball field where we smoked in a batting cage.
Nice.
And it was very interesting for me because the walk there was fine through the woods, but then the walk back being high for the first time was like...
You got high the first time?
Insane. What?
You got high the first time?
Oh, absolutely. 100%.
I mean, so did I, but usually people don't. What was the method?
It was a blunt. Thanks. And then I went back and smoked a peace pipe.
My first time was a gravity bomb.
Fun. Yo, the first time I did dabs was really interesting. I was in the backseat of one of my friend's cars, and I did, like, no one explained to me the concept of a dab. So I'm, like, pulling, and my two friends are talking in the front, and they're totally, like, zoned out. So they just, like, set me up and was like, all right, pull, you're good. And then they continued a conversation with each other, and I'm pulling, and then they turn around, they're like, oh, my God, stop. I think I like for 45 minutes, I was unresponsive. I was like coughing, crying, snorting. Aww. Like I don't even know, man. I've never felt that ever since then. But
yeah, no, same thing happened with me. Basically, no one taught me the proper way to do it. And I literally just like sunk into my friend's couch and just was like mute for an hour.
Mm-hmm.
Like people would talk to me. I'm just like, I'm answering my head, But like, words actually coming? No.
Nope.
Nope. Nowadays, what is your like preferred way to smoke? Mine is joints.
Honestly, I don't like paper as much because it smells, and then it leaves like a lingering smoke smell. And I don't know. I don't smoke besides that. So, but like probably just flower, honestly.
Just I meant like what do you call it? Like a bowl.
Oh, joints. Okay.
No, it's okay. I didn't say that correctly.
Usually I use a chillum. Yeah.
Yeah, I just learned. I thought it was always a one hitter.
It's one hitter. Whatever name you want to call it.
Yeah, I just learned chillum like 2 years ago.
Yeah, they're fun, they're cute, but usually I don't know, it's like very convenient, very nice. I enjoy that, or like the pen is nice and easy.
You already said the story, and I feel like you already would know how you would change things differently. What is something about cannabis you want people to know to like help end the stigma with it?
I think people need to stop being scared about it and like be more open-minded, because there's a lot of things that the cannabinoid industry has done for, you know, society as a whole. Like, my sister has epilepsy. Like, epilepsy in the sense that, I mean, she wasn't diagnosed from birth, but then she has these seizures, so I don't know what to call it.
Was it hormonal?
We have no clue.
Because literally, that's happens. What I was telling you earlier. That was literally what happened with me. I was 7 years old, and it started, well, you probably know the terms, the petite, and then it gradually went to a grand mal, where I would be, like, seizing. And in a span of a month, I went from a size at like 7, 8 years old from a size like 5 to 10. No difference in change of habits, and my hormones were going crazy. They put me on medication.
That's really interesting.
My mom hated me on the medication. She would say, she's like, you lost the twinkle in your eye. I'm like, okay. So she's like, can we try weaning her off and see what happens? They weaned me off for like a year, slowly but surely, and it's been 20 years and I haven't. The only time I would have to be cautious is if I ever have kids. And, like, the last trimester, yeah. I'd be, like, considered high risk because it was hormonal.
Interesting. You know, I never even considered that. Because she technically, I don't think, has been diagnosed as epileptic or having epilepsy. But, like,
same here.
She has seizures randomly, and it started, like, it feels like just a few years ago, but I know it's. You know what? I can say some more about the cannabinoid industry if you'd like.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, I think a part of, like, what I was saying about the like, it's not so scary as people think, is I think that it's done a lot for the medical side of things, like epilepsy, where my sister takes the CBD tinctures, and it helps prevent her from having seizures. And so there's, like, many different forms and varieties, and then you talk about, like, pain management and, like, people having chronic illness and not wanting to pop, like, you know, hard pills and things that you could get addicted to, and, you know, like morphine, like, you know, it's, God forbid, it can bring you down a really hard hole. And if you don't know, you know, if that addiction's in your family or something, like, you could put yourself at risk.
9 times out of 10 people who do heroin, where did they start? It's from pain pills.
Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, there's alternative ways. Like, I have chronic knee pains. Sometimes I can't walk after 8 p.m. It's just a thing. And, like, I don't know. There's no explanation for it. They can't figure it out. But the one thing that helps is weed. So when I smoke, it helps relieve pain. Literally, I say I smoke joints for my joints. My doctors.
I love that.
Well, yeah. And it's funny because, like, in the pain management, I've tried literally everything under the sun. And I've gone to specialists and whatever. And it's the only thing that helps. And they say, you know, if it helps you, then keep doing it. As long as it, you know, doesn't affect anything else. Like, if it helps, it helps. So, it, you know, there's many different ways. And then they're talking about people who maybe have depression or anxiety or, like, it just interacts with people differently, and I really think it can be used as an aid rather than a hindersome or, like, this big scary thing that's going to make you be a bad person. Like, you're still a good person if you smoke pot. It doesn't make you a bad person. It doesn't make you completely change your personality like some people think. And, yeah, I just feel like don't be so scared. Be open-minded. Me and Melissa... So me and Melissa work together a lot, and so, like, with Pine Barrens Jam, and what we've kind of segued into is our own, like, kind of branding of, like, Production Babes, where we say, you know, our slogan is we check all the boxes, because we're people who just do everything and anything and all of the time. So, like,
a jack of all trades.
Yeah, a Jill of all trades.
A Jill of all trades. You're right. I'm sorry.
Okay, it's okay. I have more masculine energy, I know. but. So, yeah, so we're really creating this network of of people who are, and it's a non-gendered term to us. We have some male production babes in our crew. It's basically just a word for somebody who, you know, is badass and just kind of does it all and isn't afraid of a challenge and has that energy and that chutzpah or whatever you want to call it. So that oomph, like, it's really cool and it's really fun. And we've met a lot of really amazing people, and it's nice to kind of create this network. And again, this is just it's a word of mouth. It's right now it's not a big thing, but we are hoping and looking forward to booking more events together. You know, we worked with Long Island Glass for their Christmas party, and we did all of the decorations for that. And
came out
planning
great.
And the, yeah, oh my God. We spent 12 hours decorating. I was on a ladder for like the majority of them, hanging things on this like 25-foot ladder.
See, that's where I'm not going to get up on a ladder.
It's probably less than 25 feet. I might be exaggerating. But I mean, I don't like heights. I don't like ladders. But there's a thing where, you know, being in audio, I have to go on scaffolding, or I have to like climb a really sketchy little hole to get to like a stage part of the stage or like a stage box. So like, and I'm the smallest person. I'm fucking tiny. So they usually send me. So it's like by necessity, I have to be okay with heights, but I'm not.
I feel you.
But it's interesting. It was really fun. It was really cool. And they do a lot of, you know, they're very cannabis friendly. And so we've been working with them a little bit more, and we're going to definitely have some more really fun events coming up soon.
I mean, it's a great place to have events.
Oh, 100%. And just what they do for the community, you know, Long Island Glass and Shakedown, like Brian and Joe are just wonderful people, and they do such a great job. And it's really nice to work with like people who are so nice and accepting and warm and like, I don't know.
And also know their stuff. Like, I didn't know Brian owned Shakedown for 20 years.
Oh, yeah.
He's been doing this for a while.
Like, it's really crazy. Now he's got a second location.
I know.
And they're really close. It's Patchogue and Medford. But, like, it's amazing to see the old store and then go to, like, the new store and then kind of see, like, the growth of it.
I love both stores. But I can't go there all the time because then I'll spend my whole paycheck.
Oh, 100%. 100%. I'm afraid of doing events in the new Shakedown because I'm going to take half of those plants home with me. It's going to be a problem. But it's really cool. And, you know, they're doing, you know, the 420 event with Bluepoint, 420 and Shakedown.
Did you go last year?
I worked it. I was the event. I was head of registration.
Nice.
So, like, I'll be running registration. It'd be really cool. And I'm excited to see what Shakedown does for their area, too. Like, last year was epic.
Yeah, I didn't get to go last year. I was working. Brian asked me if I wanted to be a vendor. I was like, yeah. Oh, that reminds me. I got to take off.
Happened last minute, like, and I have ADHD. I put things off until the last minute, but then it's perfection. Yep. Because if I don't have that anxiety and that stress of like that deadline, I'm not gonna get it done.
Yep.
But yeah.
All right, Bree, thank you so much for coming on the podcast. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.